Hi, I'm Lindsay and I am an Edumagineer. I made that word up because I think it sums up who I am and what I believe. I believe that education can and should be better, not just for the children, but for our teachers. But I'm not just a dreamer and a believer. I very much believe that it is fully within our power to engineer and to build and to architect and redesign education so that it has new meaning and that it really lives up to its potential, lives up to what education can be. I started off my career as a high school teacher. When we hear the word teacher or educator or lecturer, I think that has specific connotations for us in our minds. I think we think of the fountain of knowledge and all of sort of spewing forth all of these pieces of information. There's an American educator called Tom Loud, and he suggests that our role as teachers should not be to be obsessed with teaching, but it should be to be obsessed with learning and why or why not learning has happened in our classrooms and in the spaces that we're navigating and the spaces that we're carrying. And so I decided that I was going to rebrand myself and put down the label of teacher. And now when I work with teachers all over the country and all over the world, I offer them this new label. And so you can pick it up or put it down. But I think that we should reconceptualize and rebrand teachers to be not just teachers or educators or lecturers, but learning architects. Because ultimately, our responsibility is to design learning. In my own classroom, I saw a total reconceptualization of myself when I realized I'm a designer, I'm an architect, I'm an imaginer. The curriculum tells us what to teach, but not how. The how is actually the artistry of education. That's where we get to reimagine, that's where we get to redesign, that's where we get to be those learning architects and just make incredible learning adventures happen for our students. I started trying a whole bunch of different things, different pedagogies, different strategies in my classroom, and I saw some incredible things happen. I just saw students that were not connected to learning, were not connected to the school system, for whom it didn't really make sense. I saw them come alive in totally different ways. I saw things like the bell would ring or the lesson would end and students would stay in my classroom because they were so engaged in solving a real world problem or in creating a creative expression of their understanding of something which I'd given them as an alternative to write me the essay or complete the worksheet as a traditional assessment. I could talk all day about the magic that I saw in my classroom just by reimagining learning and focusing on learning design rather than teaching. It changed everything for me. So I then moved into a leadership space in the school. I was invited onto the senior management team as an EdTech innovation leader. So that was after a good few years of trying great things in my classroom, lots of failure, but lots of learning from that failure, lots of iterating on my practice. And I served on school leadership and looked at things like change management, coaching other teachers in that space of how do I change my pedagogy, how do I change my strategies, and how do I reimagine what education can look like in my classroom. Then I worked for a Google for Education partner for 2 years. So I worked with thousands of teachers across the country, getting them up to speed with a Google toolset, and not just from an administrative perspective, how they could add value to schools, but also how they could add value to teaching and learning. And then I started my own company at the beginning of 2019 called Teach, Learn, Innovate, with a vision to empower teachers to be learning designers. Understanding that that doesn't happen in isolation, that teachers are in schools and schools are complex organizations. So I work with school leadership teams around visioning. Often we say, we want to be progressive, we want to be innovative, we want to teach 21st century skills. But what does it really mean to be a future-focused school? What does that strategy look like? What is our vision for future-focused education? What is the culture and the fabric of learning in our school and what does that look like? And then, of course, we work with teachers, grant level, so we look at coaching, we run workshops with schools, we run workshops with teachers, we run events with teachers from multiple schools, trying to get people who teach the same grade or the same subject around a table and guide them through a learning design process. Some of it is around integrating technology, not just for the sake of technology, but so that it really adds value to the learning. And we have a lot of fun. It's been a super interesting journey for me. It's connected me with teachers all over the world. So I've become part of the Apple Distinguished Educator community, part of the Google Certified Innovator community, and really just gaining an awareness that education around the world is absolutely changing potentially faster than we can imagine. But not seeing that as a negative challenge, not seeing that as a disempowering thing, but seeing it as an opportunity for incredible growth and for innovation to take place. And I don't use that word lightly. Often we talk about innovation and nobody actually knows what we mean. I like Jeremy Notter's definition of innovation. He says, innovation is change that unlocks new value. So when I'm working with teachers and schools and they tell me, oh, we're doing this and it's innovative, and they say, well, we've got ebooks, then I ask, well, where is the new value? How is that better than a traditional textbook? So I'm always looking for new value when I work with schools, when I work with teachers. How do we make this education truly meaningful? How do we give purpose to what we're doing? And how do we remember that actually within education, it's the people, it's the teachers, it's the students, it's the leadership, it's the human element that really always has to be at the center. Where in the real world does anybody get a new boss, a new work environment, a new team, and a new project every 50 minutes? No way, right? What do school timetables look like? A new boss, teacher, a new environment, classroom, a new team, people sitting around you, and a new project, the topic, whatever we're learning, every 50 minutes. And I think sometimes we wonder why our students are so disengaged. We wonder why school feels like a prison to them, to many of them. We wonder why education just isn't meeting the needs of our students. It's not preparing them for this future where we actually cannot articulate exactly what it's going to look like. We wonder why education is not preparing them for jobs that don't exist yet. But for me, the key thing is that education doesn't look almost anything like the real world. So we have this industrial style, factory style education, churn out all of these products that can regurgitate information, and it's just entirely irrelevant. And so when I started looking at the system and when I started looking at what learning looked and felt like in my classroom, I realized that we need to redesign with the real world in mind. That's one of the principles that we can actually bring into our teaching on a daily basis. And we can still cover the curriculum. A lot of teachers will tell me, yes, Lindsay, I'd love to innovate, but. And one of the buts is, but Lindsay, we have to cover the curriculum. Another one is, but Lindsay, I don't have time. And then there are lots of other buts, which if we peel back the layers, really are just a sense of fear manifesting itself in one way or another. I don't feel equipped. I don't feel incentivized. I don't feel empowered. I don't feel like there's a why. I don't feel like we know where we're going. And that obviously just looks different on everybody. But at the heart of it, there's a real fear. The thing is, if we design education with the real world in mind, that opens up a whole world of possibility. So one of the things that I'm absolutely a fan of is designing learning around solving real world problems. So pedagogies like inquiry-based learning and project-based learning, design thinking, give teachers a structure within which to design learning so that it looks like solving real world problems. Often in those 50 minute pieces, everything is so isolated. Now I'm learning woordeskat about something in Afrikaans, and then I'm in maths and I'm learning this, and then I'm in English and I'm learning this, and then I'm in science. Whereas when we start to use real world problems to almost form an umbrella under which we can cover the curriculum from various different topics, various different subjects, then we start to see a different kind of connection. I've really seen children come alive when we connect them to real world problems. I hear often teachers say, oh, but they're only grade fours, or oh, but they're only grade sixes. And actually the reality is that we sometimes, sadly, the teachers and even parents are the ones putting ceilings on our children's growth and putting ceilings on their imagination. If we don't give them the opportunity to grapple with real problems, if we don't give them the chance to come up with an innovative solution for a problem that affects them, how will we know what they're capable of? Naturally, education is a massive system. It's a very complex system. But I do think that we need to start to shift more into a mindset and a culture where we truly invest in our teachers, where we invest in not just their education and then they go into the classroom and they do their thing, but in the continued professional development of teachers, in exposing them to progressive pedagogies, in exposing them to different strategies, in empowering them to leverage whatever technology is at their disposal to revolutionize learning in their classrooms. We cannot expect teachers to transform the system or to even provide better quality education if we're not empowering them. In the same breath, I think that parents need to have an understanding of the fact that education is not the same. The world does not demand the same things of our children. If you look at the World Economic Forum Future of Jobs report, at the top 10 skills that they identify as essential for today's workplace, we see things like negotiation and cognitive flexibility and service orientation. However, parents remain obsessed with how many A's are there on the report? What are the numbers telling me? And I think that it's in the qualitative elements of education that you can really understand, is the school truly preparing my child for the future? Is the school truly invested in the holistic development of our children? So many teachers tell me, I'd love to try this new strategy, but the parents are saying to me, why is my child's mark so low? And if we are obsessed with the numbers on the page and not obsessed with learning, teachers feel limited. They feel like their goal every day needs to go into the classroom and to teach those students, to get the information into their heads, rather than developing that natural curiosity, that wonderment in connecting them with problems. It's a different way of designing learning. But I think often teachers feel pressured by the curriculum. I have to do this. I have to cover the curriculum. I have to get these test results. I have to take care of these precious young beings in my care. However, if we think about it, the curriculum is just a tool. Much of the curriculum is Googleable. Why are we teaching our children the answers to Googleable questions when the minute they are outside the door of a classroom, they will just Google the answer? Why can't we connect them to non-Googleable questions? And that's the artistry of education. The curriculum says, teach this, teach this, teach this. These are the what's that we have to teach. But the how is actually in the hands of the learning architect. It's actually in the hands of the teacher. And so when we empower our teachers with strategies, when leadership gives teachers support to try new things, in fact, when leadership encourages teachers to fail, do something in your classroom which may or may not work as far as getting them the information goes, but will engage them in robust discussion. It will get them thinking critically. It will encourage them to understand people's perspectives. It will develop empathy. It will develop those things that our world really needs so much more than numbers on a page at the end of matric or at the end of university or at the end of a grade. Ultimately, we need children who can connect to real world problems and actually make an impact so much more than we need education to be what it used to be.